I'm the senior advisor for maternal, newborn, child, adolescent, health, aging, violence against women and midwifery in WHO Regional Office for Southeast Asia. I'm very glad to introduce our webinar series in collaboration with Indian Institute of Public Health, Gandhinagar. So first of all, I would like to welcome our distinguished speakers, Dr. Sushil Kabra and Dr. Rakesh Loda. And I'd also like to welcome Dr. Dilip Mavlankar, Director, Indian Institute of Public Health, Gandhinagar, who is our collaborator in this process. You must be wondering why we have thought of these series now. I see that there is a lot during the life course which into this COVID pandemic for last almost 7 months now. This is a 8 month going on. Every country is struggling in their own way. And the focus was first making sure that the transmission is not there, can be curtailed. And then the focus was also on reducing direct impact of COVID-19, and especially with a particular focus on reducing deaths. And this was the time that many countries got into the lockdown period, really strengthened the health system, getting the fitness in the health system. And as a result, the indirect impact of COVID-19 on the most vulnerable populations, which is women, children, adolescents, and older adults, which we call aging people, has been the maximum. So the gains which we made in terms of reducing newborn, child, maternal mortality are being lost. And it's not any aspersion on health system and countries. Our member states, the 11 member states, bounced back, and they make sure that the indirect impact is mitigated, especially on the vulnerable population. The coverage with essential health services is not disrupted. So we did some collaborative work with UNICEF in FPA and WHO at the regional level, develops guidance for the member states, ministries of health on how to mitigate the indirect impact and how to reduce disruption in services. We did the mapping, the ministries of health did the mapping with collaboration, and we shared those results where the disruption varied and the other, depending upon what is the situation of COVID, how much lockdown was there, and how much is the health system's preparedness already in place. And we have just finished on 5th, 10th August with the countries to understand, every country agrees, but how do you what strategies adopted to mitigate and address this disruption? And it was very, very interesting. So we felt very encouraged, and we thought that there is a lot of webinar fatigue which is happening, so we wait for some time and we come up with the series of webinars. So we have come up with 11 now, a series of webinars starting from today, which is Wednesday, until 28th October. There are 11 webinars which will cover the whole life course. So you can see on the screen, may I ask Neeraj to really project that where we have the list of 11 webinars. And those who have connected, I see a lot of people have connected. We will be sharing with you all the details. Our collaborator and our partner, Indian Institute of Health, Public Health, Gandhinagar, Dr. Dilip Mavlankar and his team would be sharing it. So it will be Wednesday, the same time, 1 o'clock onwards. And you can see that we are covering a range of topics. Today is the inaugural webinar, which is COVID-19 in children. And I'm very grateful to Dr. Kabra and Dr. Loda for joining in, and Dr. Deepthi, who's our colleague in country office, and Dr. Mehta to coordinate. So these series have been shared with you. I'll not go through each one of them. And I would request all of you and encourage all of you to kindly join these webinars from time to time based on your interest. So with these words, I would like to welcome you all and hope that these webinars, which WHO Regional Office for Southeast Asia, in collaboration with Institute of Public Health, is organizing, you will find these useful. We are trying to make sure that the presentations are shared and also that these webinars are available on YouTube and other social media. And Dr. Dilip Mavlankar's ABLE team is working to make sure that it reaches. And those of you who could not join, it reaches you all. With this, I would like to hand over to Dr. Dilip Mavlankar to say a few words. Over to you, Dr. Mavlankar.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nina Raina. It is a great pleasure and privilege for Indian Institute of Public Health, Gandhinagar, to collaborate and partner with WHO Southeast Asia Regional Office under your leadership to organize this series of important webinars. Indian Institute of Public Health, Gandhinagar is a joint initiative of Public Health Foundation of India and the provincial state government of Gujarat. We have been established since 2006, and we run various public health courses. Since 2015, IIPH Gandhinagar is given the status of a public health university through State Act. And since then, we have been running Master of Public Health and Master of Hospital Administration, as well as many short-term courses. The Indian Institute of Public Health, Gandhinagar, is unique in that sense that it is highly research-focused institute, and we work also closely with the state government. And we have been active in the work of COVID, as well as other maternal, child health, neonatal health, adolescent health, and even in old age related activities, programs, trainings. And we will be looking forward to this partnership between the WHO, its regional countries, and our new institute. Our vision is to become the most practical institute of public health, where future public health leaders would be trained, educated, and would be supported through continuing interaction. In achieving this goal, we see this as an important step and partnership. With this, let me again welcome all the participants who have taken time out of their busy schedule during the COVID time to participate, as well as the eminent speakers who are going to talk about this important topic. We are also struggling in the state of Gujarat to see how do we open our colleges and schools, because that is an important aspect. If we understand this disease, its spreads, its impact on children, we would definitely be able to give advice to our local government of what to do with children's education, children's other health and development activities. So this is a very important topic with which we are starting. With that, let me again thank WHO and request Dr. Rajesh Mehta to begin the deliberations. Thank you.
So good afternoon, friends. There are 189 of you linked live with us today. I thank Dr. Raina and Dr. Dilip to have set the stage for us. So as I speak today, and as per the data available on 17th of August, globally the cumulative number has risen to 21.2 million confirmed cases of COVID-19, extraordinary situation. More than 21 million people infected, and including 760,000 deaths globally. And Southeast Asia region, as you are aware, continues to report an increased number of cases currently. And we are second region in the world after Americas in terms of numbers of new cases. So presently our region is responsible for 26% of newly reported cases and 19% of deaths globally. And as we understand, India is currently going through a big surge. And for last week duration, past 7 days, India contributed to 92% of new cases in the region. So big burden, but luckily children and adolescents comprise a very small proportion globally. The experts will tell us that country reports are presently showing 1 to 5% of total reported cases which belong to this age group. However, we must be aware of a catch in the global averages. Please remember that there are some countries in the world and in our region where the population of children and adolescents actually is up to 40%. Compared to some American and European countries, it might just be 15%. So if those are the proportions in young populated countries, our numbers of infected children would be higher. So therefore, I am happy that we have eminent experts today to share with us the specific management and clinical features of the children infected with COVID-19. Disease. So today we have requested our experts to provide us with some basic but very important knowledge. And please note, on this very topic on pediatric COVID, we are arranging a separate series of webinars, 10 to 12 webinars on detailing the information which people would need to manage such children. So please stand by. That would look like a training with 12 to 15 webinars on specific topics related to management of children. And it's now my pleasure to first announce a couple of guidance notes for all of you. 193 people are online. Please write your questions along with the name of the expert you want to address in the chat box. Please write your questions during the presentations to these speakers with the name of the speaker in the chat box. And we will take these questions after all three presentations are completed. So thank you for writing your questions. My pleasure to invite the first speaker today, Dr. Sushil Kabra, who is the professor of pediatrics at All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, which is a world famous institution, a globally renowned institution. And Dr. Kabra is well recognized for his expertise in respiratory disorders in children. So Professor Kabra is going to share with us today the management of moderate COVID cases. Over to Dr. Sushil Kabra, and you have maximum of 20 minutes to present your case. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mehta. Good afternoon, friends. Welcome to this webinar series. And to begin with, we are doing it on children. So today, there will be two topics. One is management of a mild and moderate cases, and then followed by severe cases in ICU. So today, what I'm going to speak is a little bit of epidemiology. What is the case definition? How we assess the severity and management of mild and moderate cases. And lastly, I'll be talking of what are the frequently asked questions by parents and how we can manage them. If you see, Dr. Mehta has already told us that there is a significant increase from March onwards. There is a significant increase in the number of COVID tests overall in the world, as well as in our region of Southeast Asia region. And significant, we are contributing significant mortality also. So let us see what is the prevalence of the disease in children. The data of prevalence of COVID-19 infection in children is limited because of multiple causes. There is no uniform testing facility or strategy. There is selected testing, and on top of that, majority of the many patients are asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic. So they may not gain attention, and then they are not tested. and that's why there may be underrepresentation of this age group. However, data from all over world from different part suggests that proportion of children below 19 year vary between less than 1% to 3% of the total reported COVID infection. And at the same time, it is also recognized that disease is less severe. As you can see in a large series, 13% of the patients were asymptomatic, 43 had a mild disease, and 41 had a moderate disease. Severe or critically sick are just less than 3% of the world total pediatric COVID infection. And initial data from India suggests that children below 19 years of age contribute to 13% of the total cases and 3% of the total deaths. If we see that transmission is by droplet and in a close contact with the infected individual, incubation period is 5 to 7 days. It is same as that of adult, and clinical symptoms are similar to that of any influenza-like illness in form of acute cold, cough, fever, pneumonia, respiratory failure. If you see, these are the comparative statement of symptoms like fever and cough. They are the commonest in children as well, but as compared to adults, it is less in number. Similarly, headache, shortness of breath, and sore throat are more or less similar. And you can see that gastrointestinal manifestations are probably slightly more in children as compared to adults. We should be aware that there is a newly reported syndrome in a small number of children presenting with hyperinflammatory shock and mixed features of atypical Kawasaki disease and toxic shock syndrome. But it is a small, but it is an emerging illness. And you can see that the PICU admissions overall in most of the part requires less than 1% of total COVID infected children. So it is a relatively less severe. Once we say that how we can define or how we identify children with COVID infection, WHO has given four criteria. Clinical criteria include any person with at least one of the following symptoms, including cough, fever, shortness of breath, and sudden onset of anosmia. Diagnostic imaging criteria, which include X-ray or CT scan, which are compatible with COVID-19 infection. Laboratory criteria that include detection of COVID-2 by a nucleic acid in a clinical specimen. And epidemiological criteria, at least one of the following two epidemiological links should be there. Close contact with a confirmed COVID-19 case in last 14 days, having been a resident or a staff member in the 14 day prior to onset of symptom in a residential institution for vulnerable people where ongoing COVID-19 transmission has been confirmed. So these are the four criteria and how we define whether it is a possible case, probable case, and confirmed case. Any person meeting the clinical criteria of influenza-like illness, that would be a possible case as of now. And in addition, if any person meeting the clinical criteria as well as epidemiological link, it becomes a probable case, or any person meeting the diagnostic imaging criteria with clinical symptoms, then it becomes a probable case, and confirmed with any person meeting the laboratory criteria. So once we make a diagnosis of possible, probable, or confirmed, then we decide what is the severity of disease. And again, there are criteria defined for mild disease in children that includes in any child presenting with influenza-like illness, but not having respiratory difficulty. As a pediatrician, most of us know that there should not be any chest syndrome, no rapid respiratory rate, then we say that it is an influenza-like illness. Along with that, there should not be any hypoxia, meaning thereby the oxygen saturation is more than 92% in room air. And we are aware about the criteria for rapid respiratory rate. This is age specific, less than 2 months, more than 60 per minute, 3 to 11 months, more than 50 per minute, 12 to 60 months, more than 40 per minute, and more than 60 months of age, more than 30 per minute. Some children may have no fever or have only GI symptoms, and that should be kept in mind. Physical examination may be non-specific. There may be congestion of pharynx or no auscultatory abnormality. So a moderate case definition, moderate disease definition is clinical sign of known severe pneumonia, cough or difficult breathing, plus fast breathing. Along with that, no signs of severe pneumonia, oxygen saturation is less than 92%, and not feeling well. Then question comes whether there is need for any investigation. So as of now, there is no recommendation of doing any further investigation routinely in these patients, some specific investigations as indicated may be carried out. So the management can be discussed under these headings, and we'll be discussing one by one. Say, first and foremost is that all children with mild disease can be managed at home with a home isolation. So how we can decide? Mild disease as assessed by doctor and absence of risk factor for severe disease. Moderate disease as indicated by rapid respiration with or without chest drawing, but no hypoxia and feeding well. This is the group of children, they can be managed at home by home isolation. And we'll explain how we say that this patient is fit to be isolated at home. So first thing is count the respiratory rate. Cutoff should be less than age specific cutoff. If yes, then he is fit to be isolated at home, and oxygen saturation should be 92% in room air. And absence of any of these risk factors, including cardiovascular disease, diabetes, immunocompromised state, chronic lung disease, chronic kidney disease, chronic liver disease, cerebral vascular disease, obesity, and age less than 1 year, that may be a relative high risk factor. So, then there is a social eligibility criteria for home isolation, and these include the patient has a requisite facility for isolation at his or her residence, and also for quarantine of the family contacts. It should be yes. Caregiver is available to provide care on a 24/7 basis. If available, we should use a country specific app for tracking COVID-19 positive cases. As for example, in India, it is a Arogya Setu app. But the parent's caregiver has agreed to monitor health of the child and regularly inform his or her health status to the surveillance officer or to the doctor. The parents or caregiver have filled an undertaking on self-isolation and self-follow home isolation quarantine guideline. If all these things are yes, and in the previous slide, all those things are yes, then we can decide about home isolation and management at home. So if home isolation is not feasible due to any of the reason which we discussed till now, because of small house or overcrowding at home, high risk parents, patients or parents are staying at home and inadequate facility, regular monitoring is not possible due to any reason, and if the child has a risk factor, immunosuppressed, chronic disease, etc., that we discussed in the previous slide, then we should be keeping them, even if it is assessed to be a mild disease, we should be keeping the child in a COVID care facility. However, we should be aware that all children at home isolation, COVID care facility or hospital should be cared in child-friendly environment, and parents attendant may be allowed to take care of the child with proper PPE and precautions. So once we have decided that yes, the child can be managed at home, we have to train a parent over at a home or paramedical worker who may be taking care at the COVID care facility. We have to explain them that they have to maintain a monitoring chart, which I'll be showing in the next slide. Counting of respiratory rate 2 to 3 times a day, looking for chest drawing, nasal flare, voice discoloration, cold extremities, urine output, oxygen saturation if it is available by using a handheld pulse oximeter, communication with the doctor, and whom to contact in case of emergency. And we have to explain to the paramedical worker as well as to the parents if they are taking care at home, when to bring them to the hospital or seek help, consider transfer to the hospital. These are the things that if a child develops a breathing difficulty as indicated by rapid respiratory rate, chest drawing, nasal flare, voice discoloration, reduced activity or lethargy, poor feeding, altered sensorium, seizure, hypoxia, if monitored, suggested by oxygen saturation of less than 92%. And this is a suggested monitoring chart to be filled at home or COVID care center that include these vital parameters, oxygen saturation, and other symptoms. That should be done at least 3 times a day so that we can pick these patients if there is a deterioration. So now question come, how to manage these moderate cases? As we know, it is defined as a pneumonia, fast breathing, age-specific cutoff, chest drawing, and oxygen saturation is less than 92%. If it is more than 92% and feeding well, then they will be managed at home and impaired feeding. And they should be admitted in a COVID hospital, started in oxygen inhalation, monitor for progress, feeds, fluids, and avoid dehydration or overhydration. Antipyretics, paracetamol, and these patients are candidates for antibiotics. Also, as we use it in our IMNCI, we can use antibiotics. So symptomatic treatment for paracetamol, it would be 15 milligram per kilo per dose of paracetamol 4 to 6 hourly. Avoid non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agents like ibuprofen, methylamine acid, etc. in this season, though there is no evidence against these as of now for use in pediatric patients with COVID infection. But now this is the season for other infections also, including dengue infection. In that, these are contraindicated. Cough suppressants, there is no role. We can use household remedies for throat soothing, including warm saline gargles in older children and adolescents, and henny can be given in infants. But henny can be used as a soothing agent, but try to avoid it in infants. And in mild disease, no antibiotics are required, but in moderate disease, as indicated by tachypnea chest drawing, amoxicillin orally for 5 days can be given. Specific treatment in form of hydroxychloroquine, favipiravir, all these do not have any indication in mild to moderate disease, as there are no evidence for their beneficial role. So there is no role of hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine, favipiravir, ivermectin, antiviral like remdesivir, or immunomodulators such as tocilizumab, interferon beta 1a, convalescent plasma, or dexamethasone. These are true for all mild and moderate diseases in pediatric patients. When to consider to COVID transfer to COVID 19 hospital? So these parents should be told about which is the nearest COVID hospital or facility, and if any of the following is present, either the patient is being managed in COVID care facility or at home: worsening of respiratory distress, as indicated by increasing respiratory rate, chest syndrome, oxygen saturation going down below 92% in room air, developing poor peripheral perfusion, poor oral intake, lethargy or seizures, or encephalopathy. Any of these things are there, immediately consult the doctor and then they should be admitted in a COVID hospital. And now we discuss some frequently asked questions. How many days to isolate the child with mild COVID-19, even if we are treating it at home? A child who is admitted can be discharged after at least 10 days of the symptom onset and at least 3 days of afebrile period. So this is applicable to the home also. Further home isolation for next 7 days with the health monitoring at home is also recommended. For example, a child, he is symptomatic for 8 days and can be discharged on day 11 of onset of symptom if the child is afebrile for last 3 days. This should be followed by home isolation for 7 days. Whether to repeat a COVID test? So there is no recommendation for repeating RT-PCR or any other test which was done in the beginning, unless there is a high risk factor or high risk group of patients may be repeated. How can the risk of transmission of illness from child to other family members be reduced? So we have to explain it very clearly to the family, as there may be risk of some transmission. Precautions including mask, physical distancing, hand hygiene and isolation should be maintained very carefully. Does the child need a vaccination after infection? This is something like a specific vaccine for COVID-19. This is not a contraindication for giving a routine vaccination. So as of now for COVID-19, there is no vaccine is available. It's unclear whether the infection provide a lifelong immunity or child will be at risk of repeat infection. Therefore, when the vaccine is available, by that time we will have more data and we may be in a better position to say whether the child requires a vaccine. Will the child have a long-term complication? As this is a new condition, long-term complications are difficult to predict. With more studies, guidelines may be developed. It may be desirable to clinically follow up these patients. For adults, we are seeing that those who had a severe disease, they are having a severe pulmonary fibrosis. But routine mild to moderate illnesses, they are not having a significant problem. When can child be sent to school or play with other children? So in that case, we have to follow the rules and regulation formed by our government or local bodies. But it may be once they allow schools are open, then it may be considered 10 days after the child become afebrile, presuming that after that child will not be infectious to others. To summarize, COVID-19 infection in children is less common and less severe. Majority of children with COVID-19 infection have a mild illness characterized by cold, cough, but no difficulty in respiration. Respiratory rate is less than age-specific cutoff, no chest syndrome, and no hypoxia. These patients can be managed at home with home isolation after assessment. Those with moderate disease should be admitted in a COVID-19 hospital and provided with supportive and care and a very careful monitoring to pick up very early deterioration so that we can shift them to the intensive care. There is no evidence to suggest beneficial role of antiviral, hydroxychloroquine, tocilizumab, plasma infusion or steroid in children with mild to moderate disease. Case fatality rate is less than children. Should be aware about atypical manifestations, including hyperinflammatory syndrome with multi-organ dysfunction. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Professor Sushil Kabra. This was very clear conveyance of the guidance you provided for mild to moderate cases. And you already anticipated some questions and also have already answered them. I still encourage, there are 232 people now joining us in this webinar, to write their questions for Dr. Kabra in the chat box, and we will try to accommodate as many as possible. Thank you, Dr. Sushil, for your excellent presentation and setting the role model for keeping to time. Now, my pleasure to invite the next expert, Professor Rakesh Lodha. He is also working in All India Institute of Medical Sciences as Professor of Pediatrics, and is a renowned pediatric intensivist and has been part of some global technical groups through WHO on several occasions. So today he will be speaking on management of severe cases of COVID in children. Over to Professor Rakesh.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Dr. Mehta, for a kind introduction. And it's a pleasure to be on this webinar. So, over next 20 minutes or so, I'm going to be talking a bit about COVID-related ICU care and intend to cover indications of admission to ICU, briefly touching upon respiratory failure strategy for ARDS, how to manage shock, at the same time covering... am I audible? Yeah, am I audible now?
People can hear you.
Sir, can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I think we'll restart then. Yeah, sorry.
Yes, Professor Rakesh, if you can start from your first slide, please.
Yeah.
We are sorry about this.
So, yes. So, I think I'll talk about indication for admission to the ICU, a bit about respiratory failure, ARDS, some of the common strategies, and what we could do if we don't have specific equipment. Covering on shock, and also briefly cover the drugs that have been used in adults and what their status is in children. A brief about the multisystem inflammatory syndrome in children. And so let's first come to, you know, what are the rates of hospitalization and ICU admission in children. So Dr. Kabra highlighted that most of the children have either asymptomatic illness or they have mild illness, which doesn't really need hospitalization. And we have limited information about severe COVID-19 would need hospitalization in a formal way. So amongst a few studies which have compared the head-to-head comparison of the admission rates amongst children with what happens in adults, this study from the United States seems to suggest that the admission rates or hospitalization rates among children are about 24 lower as compared to adults. And among those who are hospitalized, up to 1 in 3 children may need ICU care. So overall number of children who may need ICU care may not be very high. Now, when do we need to admit children who have COVID to the ICU? So the first major indication is when they need respiratory support or they have features of ARDS. And they would need to be managed by like high flow nasal cannula or non-invasive ventilation and mechanical ventilation after intubation. At times, we can give HFNC and NIV in a high dependency unit setting as well. Children who have hemodynamic instability, who have features of shock, would be better managed in a pediatric intensive care unit. Children who have altered mental status or who have multisystem inflammatory syndrome. Children having multi-organ dysfunction, and some of the critical ill children may also have acute kidney injury, so they would be better managed in ICU. And then many a times it's the underlying disease or condition which requires the ICU care. And the COVID diagnosis is more or less, you could say, incidental. So there could be a child with congenital heart disease and cardiac failure, which may be primarily be explained by the cardiac lesion and is tested COVID positive. So in that setting, the child would need ICU care. So optimally, an isolation room with negative pressure is what is recommended, but we do understand that in most settings, we may not have this available. So at times, children are managed in a separate ICU for all COVID-19 patients, and where even adults may be managed. Irrespective of where the child is managed, it's important that the healthcare professionals have adequate personal protective equipment. And in these kind of settings, particularly when children are likely to undergo either non-invasive or invasive ventilation, or there may be aerosol generating procedures, the use of an appropriate respirator, N95 or a FFP2 or a equivalent respirator is what would be desirable in these settings. Now, let's just quickly look at some of the published literature. This is like recent one I'm taking up a series from Brazil and another from New York City, about 70 to 80 children. And the common indications for admission to the ICU were mainly respiratory in both these scenarios, children either having pneumonia or ARDS. Then the other indications include shock, sepsis, neurological conditions, and also multisystem inflammatory syndrome. Now, what is interesting to look at is that irrespective of whether we see the Brazilian series or the American series, about 40 to 75% of the children who were admitted to the ICU had at least one underlying comorbidity. And these could include static encephalopathies, malignancies, chronic respiratory disease, congenital heart disease. Now, the respiratory failure is the main indication. And what kind of respiratory support may be needed? So we could rely on non-invasive support for early ARDS or severe pneumonia setting. High flow nasal cannula, we have specific devices, commercially available devices. For CPAP and BiPAP, either we could be using standalone devices, or at times the ICU ventilator has an option for non-invasive ventilation. But we need to make sure that we need to use appropriate fitting mask so that there is minimal leak around it. And having said that, it would be desirable to use a non-vented mask as compared to a vented mask, which is available with some of the commercially available equipment. The major concern with these are the high aerosol generation due to high flow rates, particularly with high flow nasal cannula, and also leakage around the seal of the mask. For settings where we may not have a high flow nasal cannula device, we have been using indigenously put up HFNC thing. What it needs is an oxygen source which can give high flow oxygen, or preferably it may be better to have oxygen air mixture, a blender, a servo controlled humidifier, which is a heated wire humidifier, a corrugated tubing, which is the ventilator circuit, and the nasal prongs. And this particular pictorial here shows us what we need. So we need to have an oxygen source, where we get in the gas flow into a servo-controlled humidifier. This is the outlet, which has a heater wire within. And at the end of that, we can connect it to the prongs. And this prongs can then be connected, applied on the infants or the child stage. You just need to use appropriate size forms. And we could use flow rates which are dependent. So typically, the high flow nasal cannula flow rates are 1 to 2 liters per minute, 1 to 2 liters per kg per minute. But in this kind of a setting, because we are concerned about aerosol generation, we may choose 0.5 to 1 ml per kg. Now, the issue is that there have been studies, and we all are worried about that when we apply a high flow source, be it an oxygen by a nasal cannula or by a mask or a non-rebreathing mask or HFNC, then we need to see what happens, you know, in terms of the exhaled air dispersion. So this particular study published in European Respiratory Reviews, this was conducted in a negative pressure room with at least 6 air changes per hour. And we can see that the exhaled air dispersion, again, this is mainly data from adults, it could be as high as 100 centimeters. Similarly, NIV by a full face mask, it may be about 92 centimeters. And some of this thing risk could be mitigated or reduced by using applying a simple surgical face mask on over whatever interface you're using, something like this. So this may be something that may be useful, particularly in many of our settings. We may not have a negative pressure room with appropriate air changes. Now, it's important that we use HFNC and NIV before invasive ventilation, because it's not just ventilation, it brings with it the need for intensive care per se, having trained personnel, having required equipment. And as I mentioned, we use a lower flow rate for HFNC in these settings. If it's possible for older children, we may have oronasal or helmet interfaces rather than preferring a nasal interface, because that would reduce the spread of the aerosol that's generated. We need to minimize the leak around the NIV interface. For NIV support, it's desirable to use a double limb circuit with a non-vented mask. And we would apply some filters on the expiratory limb to make sure that the exhaled air doesn't leak out unfiltered into the environment. And again, to re-emphasize, healthcare workers who are working with these kind of patients should have appropriate PPE with a respirator for their safety. Now, if a child needs mechanical ventilation, doesn't maintain oxygenation on the previous devices, interfaces, or the child has shock that's worsening, or the sensorium is poor, then this child would need intubation, and this should preferably be done by an experienced physician with minimum number of people around the patient at that time. Better to use cupped endotracheal tubes. It would be desirable to pre-oxygenate with a non-rebreathing mask rather than doing bag and mask ventilation, again, because of risk of spread of aerosol. If one has to use a bag and mask, then one would use a viral filter between the face mask and the expiratory valve. We need to ensure good seal between mask and the face. And if it's possible, a video laryngoscope or a fiber optic scope guided intubation may be desirable, just to make sure that the intubation is done easily and we don't face any challenges. Now, for mechanical ventilation, for ARDS and seven pneumonias, we would go in for low tidal volume strategy, making sure we give adequate PEEP. We use these viral filters in the expiratory limb. So this is a viral filter that's been put up in the expiratory limb. And if it's possible, use a heat and moisture exchanger, which also comes in with a viral filter instead of a heated wire humidifier. So this may be an option to use, and then we don't need a heated wire humidifier. And it would be desirable, if you're using a heated wire humidifier, to have a viral filter at the end of the expiratory circuit before the gases enter the expiratory circuit of the ventilator. Now, in addition to the usual ventilation or refractory hypoxemia, we may have to do prone ventilation. And in adults, it's being shown that the awake prone positioning, which means a person is actually not on an invasive mechanical ventilator, but even those individuals benefit from lying in a prone position for prolonged periods of time. The other issue is about adjunctive steroids. So we have data which comes in from the recovery trial for adults that there has been improved survival with dexamethasone at low doses. In children with ARDS, we may use either methylprednisone 1 to 2 mg per kg per day for 5 days or dexamethasone at 0.2 to 0.4 mg per kg per day for 5 days. In really extreme scenarios, there may be need for ECMO, but again, in many of our facilities, this is not routinely available. And then there may be a role for low molecular weight heparin, and we'll discuss a little bit more about it, because there has been evidence of thrombosis and endothelitis in lungs of COVID-19 patients who are succumbed and underwent autopsy. Also, it's been seen that DVT has increased during the COVID-19 pandemic. Again, data mainly from adults, and therefore low molecular weight heparin may be routinely recommended in adults with COVID-19 and respiratory difficulty. And the use of twice daily enoxaparin was associated with lower mortality than once daily, and which was statistically significant. However, in children, it's not really reported that thrombosis is a major problem, and therefore low molecular weight heparin is generally not to be used. Recently, there have been guidelines in the Journal of Pediatric Blood and Cancer, where essentially they have limited it to settings where there may be a strong family history of venous thromboembolism, or an indwelling central venous line and two or more risk factors, or four or more risk factors. Now, these risk factors typically are related to history of thrombophilia, or possibly related with a thromboembolism, presence of central line, post-pubertal age, decreased mobility, burns, active malignancies, estrogen therapy, active systemic infection, a flare of inflammatory disease, obesity, severe dehydration, recent surgery or trauma. So some of these may be used as a guideline, but we still don't have any definitive evidence for routine use of low molecular weight heparin. Now, briefly touching upon the drugs that are in use. So we know that there are a large number of drugs which are essentially repurposed drugs have been in use. There isn't really very strong evidence, and at this time point, even the WHO kind of suggests use of these only in a research or a trial setting, or we would say on a case-to-case basis, weighing in the risks and benefits of using these drugs. So hydroxychloroquine may be used in 7 to 8 mg/kg twice a day on day one, followed by 7 to 8 mg/kg once a day. Again, there's no definite evidence for benefit, no trials in children. Remdesivir has been used. There's some studies in adults suggesting more modest benefit. Again, no survival benefit, but some decrease in duration of hospital stay. For less than 40, there's an emergency use authorization by the FDA, but let's say in India, it's still not approved by a drug controller. So one would have to use, if one uses, has to use it with caution, weighing in the risks and benefits, and day after taking appropriate consent from the family. Favipiravir is approved in India for use in adults with mild disease. Again, the data supporting the use may not be very strong. Lopinavir, ritonavir, anti-HIV drug has again, it was suggested initially, but the studies really don't show any benefit. Tocilizumab is something which may be used for so-called cytokine storm. And again, these are the doses, about 8 mg/kg, body weight and 2 infusions, 12 hours apart. And recently, a large RCT doesn't seem to suggest benefit. So again, there may be only some indication on a case-to-case basis. No molecular weight heparin, we have already discussed. In addition, there are other things which are people are trying out, a convalescent plasma, zinc, ivermectin, vitamin C supplementation. But again, there is no definitive evidence to support use of these. This we have already talked about, but again, just to reemphasize that this may be considered only after considering risk benefit on a case-to-case basis, and we need to take consent from the family. Tocilizumab may be considered in presence of race inflammatory markers, CRP, ferritin, IL-6, but at times we may not be able to get these reports quickly. So if one is considering in a critically ill child who continues to worsen despite supportive care, one may consider using it. And the same probably would be true for convalescent plasma. Again, this is awaiting results of a large trial that currently is being carried out in the country. If it's likely to work by neutralizing the virus, the role may only be in early during the illness if the illness is severe enough. For shock, we need to evaluate for myocardial dysfunction and myocarditis. And there has to be cautious fluid resuscitation, 10 to 12 ml per kg over 30 to 60 minutes, and early inotropic support is what would be required. We cannot really, the importance of supportive care in this setting when we don't have very well-defined or definitive antiviral therapies is tremendous. Organ support, so children with AKI may be needing renal replacement, be it peritoneal or a hemodialysis. Appropriate blood component therapy, need to maintain blood sugars between 100 to 180 milligram per DL, preventing pressure injuries, appropriate sedation and analgesics, prevent deep vein thrombosis in high-risk group, and wherever possible, an early mobilization. Now, this just shows what people have used in different settings. So in Brazil, people have most of the children needed, about 65% needed some respiratory support, majority needing only oxygen about 6% needed NIV and about fifth needed IMB. And frozen positioning was required in 4%. On the other hand, in the series from New York ICU, about 43% needed nasal cannula oxygen, 30% HFNC, about 30% again invasive mechanical ventilation, and 10% required prone positioning. The drugs that people used are again antibiotics. Again, the WHO guidelines kind of recommend against routine use of antibiotics. Only when one is suspecting strongly a bacterial infection would one use it. But in many settings, it's not possible to really rule out a bacterial infection. So many of the units do end up. So both series, about 70% scenarios, cases of antibiotics were used. Hydroxychloroquine had been used in about 40%, remdesivir in about 20%, steroids in about 30%. And again, the biologicals, the IL-6 or IL-1 inhibitors in a very small proportion. In Brazil, they didn't really use any hydroxychloroquine. It was mainly supportive care. The outcomes in PICU are the mortality is low, less than 5%. The median length of stay may be about 5 days. So overall outcomes aren't tough. They seem to do well if given appropriate care. Now, Dr. Cabra did mention about an upcoming syndrome, that is multisystem inflammatory syndrome, which is temporarily related to COVID-19. It's a Kawasaki disease-like illness, and it's increasingly been reported from areas that had high COVID-19 case burden, and often a lag of about 4 to 6 weeks has been shown. So possibly it looks like to be immune-mediated or immune dysregulation-related mechanism. These are the WHO case definition for surveillance purposes. Age less than 19 years, fever which is lasting for 3 days or more, clinical signs of multisystem involvement, at least two or more of following, rash, hypotension, cardiac dysfunction, evidence of coagulopathy, acute gastrointestinal symptoms. So two of or more of these, elevated inflammatory markers, and no other obvious microbial cause of inflammation, and evidence of SARS-CoV-2 infection, either positive RT-PCR, positive serology, or antigen test, or a contact with a positive case. These therapies here are mainly around immunomodulation. One has options of either using intravenous immunoglobulin or low to moderate dose steroids. Aspirin is used if there are Kawasaki-like features or there is thrombocytosis, or the echocardiography shows some dilatation of the coronaries. And one may use low molecular weight heparin if there is thrombosis or ejection fraction is low. And again, as discussed, biologics may be used, but again, there are no well-defined evidence-based guidelines for management of this. So to sum up, severe COVID-19 is infrequent in children. A few children, however, would require ICU care, and most of them have an underlying comorbidity. Common indications are respiratory failure, ARDS, multisystem inflammatory syndrome. The mainstay of management in absence of a proven antiviral therapy still remains supportive care. So many repurposed drugs have been used, but one would use these with caution, as these are not really strongly evidence-based for children. And the outcomes so far with appropriate supportive care have been reported to be excellent. So we can have sick children, and if we manage them well, most of them would have a good outcome. Thank you for patient listening.
Very well done, Professor Rakesh. Clear guidance available from you on management of severe cases. There were a few questions after Sushil's presentation on multi-system inflammatory syndrome. So you already provided some more details. But again, to remind our audience that we will have detailed webinars on pediatric COVID management, actually addressing each of the topic in detail about healthcare worker protection, about how to provide the health system within the health facilities, how to support the parents, so, and specific treatments of the different manifestations. So please stand by for that webinar series. Today we had an efficient set of speakers. So thank you, Professor Rakesh Lodha, for sharing with us the specific guidelines.
Thank you, sir.
After that, I must actually add a bit here. Dr. Raina, in her opening speech, reminded that while we have seen from Dr. Sushil and Dr. Rakesh the effect of the infection on children, but Dr. Raina pointed out there are indirect effects of the pandemic itself in children who are not infected, but they get affected because the routine services have been disrupted. so which is very common. And not only health services, the nutrition services, the education services have been interrupted. So there are adverse effects on these children and adolescents. Malnutrition probably will worsen because there is an economic disruption. People can't afford food. I'm talking about vulnerable marginalized communities. The midday school meal, which was available to them, would not be available because schools are closed. And then school closure itself leads to so much of social isolation in this vulnerable period, exposes them to anxiety, stress, fear of the infection. They become more vulnerable to abuse and punishment and physical punishment, violence. So all of those indirect effects are not covered today. But in our webinar series, there are opportunities to learn about that. So please remember to join us for the next webinars also to understand the indirect effect on children and adolescents. So after after you know this useful discussions, presentations on clinical features, now we shift our attention to another important topic. I think we heard from Sushil that we must observe our cases, the population of cases in our own countries prospectively closely, so that we can understand the disease in this age group much better. And maybe look forward to the clinical protocols followed and what clinical outcomes were secured. So therefore, this is my pleasure to invite Dr. Deepti Agarwal, who is a national professional officer at WHO India office, to share with us the initial conceptual clarity on the COVID registry, the prospective studies to observe, understand the disease in COVID positive cases. Over to Dr. Deepti Agarwal. So Dr. Deepti, you can unmute yourself. We can't hear you.
Okay. Good afternoon. And thank you, Dr. Mehta, for the introduction. And can you see my presentation?
Yes, we can. Please move the slide.
Okay. So as Dr. Kabra has already shared in his presentation today, we know that the data, available data on children under 19 years comprises only a very small subset of the reported cases, maybe around 1 to 5%. And most of these reported cases are likely to be asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic, also making it less likely that they are hospitalized. So understandably, most published data that is derived is from symptomatic adults, as they constitute the larger proportion of reported and hospitalized cases. In this context, in my presentation today, I will discuss about the important global and India initiatives to systematically collect data across different settings and subpopulations, including children, so, pregnant, and then
excuse me, Deepti, can you move the slide, please?
Yeah, I will. Yeah. So in my presentation, I shall first provide a bird's eye view of the WHO's global clinical platform. And following this, I will share a few examples from India, which have been informed by the global platform. So we do recognize that the scenario for pediatric population is different, and our knowledge about clinical and laboratory characteristics, as well as prognosis of children with COVID-19 is quite limited. We've just seen that there are two data sets from New York and Brazil with around 70 to 82 cases per study, and how there were differences in the clinical presentation, the supportive care required, and the therapies. So we also know that there's been a great variability in case fatality rates reported from various countries, and the prevalence of a different genomic variant, susceptibility of children, and environmental factors in low middle income countries like India could affect the severity and course of COVID-19 disease in our children, but which we might only be able to deduct from a large data set of systematically collected data. So to increase our understanding of the severity, spectrum, and impact of COVID-19 among hospitalized populations globally and in different countries, WHO launched the COVID-19 clinical data platform. This data platform enables countries to share clinical information of patients with suspected or confirmed COVID-19 disease, and it helps in characterization of key clinical features of hospitalized cases as well as characterization of clinical interventions, which are critical to operational planning during the pandemic. Here on the screen, you will see a screenshot of the homepage of the Global Clinical Data Platform. As a surveillance activity of public health importance, this web-based electronic data platform not only enables systematic collection of clinical data, but it also facilitates aggregation, tabulation, and data analysis across different settings and subpopulations globally. On the homepage, you will also find the link to register for the platform. Also on the homepages are links to the standard case report forms as well as instructions to complete and upload the data. So all countries, health facilities, and clinical establishments can voluntarily participate and contribute to this global effort. And here I would like to highlight an important aspect. Upon submission of data to the WHO clinical database, the contributors can access the data set in an analyzable format, and contributors can also publish the data individually or collectively in their own names in peer-reviewed journals or elsewhere. So if you would like to participate, then you have to follow a simple process. Create your profile by going through the link that I just showed in the previous slide. And in 24 to 48 hours, you'll be receiving a login credential and you can begin to report into the database. If you require any assistance, you can contact the database administrator on the given email ID, or you can reach out to us at the WHO regional office and we will facilitate the process. To harmonize the data collection across diverse global settings, WHO has developed a standard case reporting form, and these forms contain a minimum set of key variables, which forms the basis of three type of case reporting formats. So you can see them and you will find the links to them on the homepage. The first one is the core case reporting form, which is for recording data relating to general population of hospitalized patients. There's a module for pregnancy. So it's the pregnancy case reporting form to record additional information relating to subgroup of hospitalized pregnant women. Also now there's currently a reporting form available for multi-system inflammatory syndrome in children and adolescents. So those suspected with these cases can also be reported. In addition, there are links to the information sheet and instructions to complete the CRF, and you can find all of them on the homepage. A few words about the CRF design and structure. The core case reporting form consists of three modules. The first module has to be completed on first day of admission, and it consists of some common information related to demographics, vital signs, presenting symptoms, comorbidities, medications, and investigations. There's a second module which can be completed on the first day of admission to ICU or completed daily for as many days as the hospital resources allow. And in the final, the third module is the one that is completed at discharge or death. And this includes the final results of the pathogen testing, medication, supportive care, and outcomes. So this is about the global database supported by WHO. In addition, in India, ICMR is launching a national clinical registry for COVID-19 for collection of data for COVID-19 patients who are hospitalized. And ICMR proposes to collect data from 100 hospitals over a duration of 1 year. And to be included in this national registry, the hospitals must receive at least 100 COVID-19 patients in a month. And these sites will be mentored and supervised by medical institutes of repute, including the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. So besides the national registry now, I would like to share two other examples from India of the initiatives that are being supported by WHO. First one is SCOPE, or the standardization of COVID in pregnancy. It is a multi-center cohort surveillance of limited duration. The objective of this study is to undertake standardized data collection and documentation of clinical outcomes in all pregnant women and their newborns who are admitted to the participating hospitals. And in addition, we would like to take this opportunity to standardize the treatment protocols for COVID-19 infection in pregnancy in the participating hospitals. The India initiative will be enrolling all pregnant women and pregnant and postpartum women with lab-confirmed COVID-19 who are admitted to any of these four collaborating centers and their 17 satellite centers, which are all tertiary care hospitals. and detailed information will be gathered for COVID positive pregnant women and their newborns using the WHO case report forms, which are the same as for the global clinical data platform. Additionally, clinical information will also be recorded for pregnant women and newborns who are clinical suspects, so that comparable data is available to compare the outcomes in those who are COVID positive and are COVID negative women who are reporting to hospitals during the time of the pandemic. So at this point of time, the duration of this study is from April to September, and all those women who are enrolled before the start of the study will be enrolled retrospectively, and the data will be abstracted from the case record forms. And depending on how the pandemic evolves, there could be a possibility of further extension of the study. And in addition to the data abstraction on key variables, which aligns with the global clinical data platform, there are some additional variables we have brought into the study. So to study the vertical transmission in mothers and newborns, and to document this, we will also be including a collection of certain specimens in prospectively recruited antenatal women. This will include maternal and newborn neonatal neuropharyngeal swabs for RT-PCR, histopathology of the placenta, amniotic fluid and breast milk samples for RT-PCR, and if possible, cord blood for both RT-PCR and IgM. Another feature that we have brought into the study is the follow-up of the mothers and newborns up to 6 weeks after delivery. And in the centers where it is possible, a scan will be, neonatal brain imaging will be undertaken for any evidence of hypoxic injury or clinical follow-up for neurodevelopmental outcome. So this is about our initiative to standardize data collection for newborns and pregnant women. Okay. The second initiative that I would like to introduce here is the India Pediatric COVID Case Registry. So this is a new initiative that we are proposing with the Indian Academy of Pediatrics, which is a pediatric association with more than 33,000 members across the country. And again, the aim of this study is to describe the clinical presentation, management and outcomes associated with COVID-19 disease among pediatric age group in India. The objectives of this study are quite similar to the one that I just discussed. Here again, we would like to undertake standardized data collection and documentation of clinical course and outcomes in children admitted with COVID-19 disease, and to standardize the treatment protocols for children in the registry hospitals or the reporting centers. And we hope to provide descriptive analysis on clinical presentation, management and outcomes in pediatric patients across the country. The eligibility for children to be enrolled in the study are children aged 0 to 18 years with a positive COVID-19 diagnostic test who are admitted to the participating hospitals between March to December 2020. So this study is going to be initiated very soon in August, and since we will be analyzing a lot of retrospective data, this study is likely to go on till next year. The scope and duration of the study, here we will again use the standardized case report forms, which will be adapted from the WHO clinical data platform. And data will be collected retrospectively if the children were admitted before the initiation of the study, and prospective data will be collected from August to December 2020.
So thank you, Deepthi, for taking us through. So you have one more slide? Go ahead.
Yeah, yes, I'll complete very quickly. Yeah. So for the data flow, the registry centers will abstract data from the information on the records that are already available in the hospitals, and anonymized data will be entered into standardized formats, both online and offline. And this aggregated and anonymized data then shall be made available as reports. In the implementation plan, we intend to enroll around 25 centers who will all participate voluntarily. The important thing is the ability to share the data, and I think we will be having around 25 private hospitals enrolled for the study. There'll be a identified coordinator for each study, for each center, and they will be oriented on the clinical reporting formats as well as the standard management protocols. Quality assurance will be assured by a designated team with research experience. There will be back-end support also from a team which will troubleshoot in case if it is required by the participating centers. And a task force will be established, which will be providing periodic updates from the aggregated data. So what is the value add that will be brought about by the India initiatives? So in addition to the data that is already available on the global platform and in the national registry, we hope to, you know, bring in more private hospitals and get representation for smaller hospitals and private setups, which may otherwise not get space in the national registry. So it adds to the data sets. And since we're using the standardized case reporting formats from the global platform, we hope that much of this data variables will be comparable. In addition, we will also be helping to standardize the care of patients in all these participating centers. Plus, I think the professional associations will be able to provide more, you know, India-specific guidance based on the experience and the data that is available from this study. And it might serve other, you know, predetermined clinical and scientific purposes in India. So before I end my presentation, I would just like to acknowledge that the work that I'm presenting today is a collaborative effort of a lot of people, including our senior advisors in the WHO regional offices, the teams both at regional office and country office, the WHO collaborating centers, including AIIMS, the Pediatric Association, Indian Academy of Pediatrics, and a lot of participating hospitals. And we hope that we can bring more details about this initiative and reports in the future. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, Deepthi Agarwal, for letting us know the plans and an example of COVID registry. That primarily means that if we can bring in some hospitals together, the numbers of cases are going to be very small. So unless we network with hospitals and try to study these cases in terms of prospectively understanding the clinical features to better define the clinical profile in our population, in Indonesia, in India, Bangladesh. Who knows, we may be different populations and disease may behave differently. So it is a good idea to prospectively collect data in a standardized manner, and WHO offers a good standard case reporting form. So there are options. So professionals are clearly important, although the ICMR, which is the lead leading research association of Government of India, is setting up a registry among hospitals to women and newborns born to positive parents, and also registry for children. Similarly, Indian Academy of Pediatrics, the professional society, and the OBGY societies are also trying to set up additional hospitals for standardized data. So thank you, Deepthi, for giving us an overview of the initial phase of planning, which is available. So other countries must also consider the same to understand the disease. The opportunity will be to also introduce standard treatment protocols. And there are a lot of questions around those protocols in the question box. So it would be a good idea to introduce in these hospitals standard treatment protocols and understand what are the clinical outcomes. So I thank all the speakers, but now we get on to the questions and answers. First to Dr. Sushil, there are questions related specifically to pointed questions on clinical protocols and the danger signs and all. So I think we have limited time to address those questions, and Dr. Harish Kumar can personally get in touch with us and we can together prepare some answers to pointed clinical questions of case scenario and primary health management. But Dr. Sushil, there is interest in understanding the newborn care. We did not cover today the care of positive newborns or newborns born to the positive mother. If you can spend quickly a few minutes to a few half a minute or 1 minute to explain that, if there are some specific newborn care issues. Because the disease is mild, if it even if the babies become positive. And the other set of questions is also related to healthcare personnel. If you can also provide a little bit brief guidance on what kind of nursing care would be there, and is there a special need for healthcare workers to protect themselves from positive children who might infect the healthcare workers or their family members? So if you can address these two, then we can move on to the next set. Dr. Sushil, please.
Thank you, Dr. Rajesh. First, let us see the newborn. So there are reports that transmission from mother to baby, theoretically we may say that it is a vertical transmission versus postnatally acquired disease. And the vertical transmission is still very less or not significantly documented. Chances of vertical transmission are there, but they are very less. Similarly, postnatal transmission, it depends on when you are testing the newborn. On day 1 or day 2, it may be negative, but on day 5, it should be tested. As far as care of these newborns are concerned, they should be kept with the mother with the proper explanation of using a PPE so that she doesn't transfer the disease. She can continue to give a breastfeeding and observe for any problems in form of development of influenza-like illness, respiratory difficulty, or any lethargy or poor feeding. In those situations, they may be specifically tested and treated accordingly. But as such, I can say in summary, transmission is minimal, but they require specific precautions for the mother as well as the family members. They should be treated like any other newborn, and breastfeeding may be encouraged or continued after explaining to the family. Observe for development of any lethargy, poor feeding, cough, or respiratory difficulty, and treat it accordingly after investigation. So this is about the care of newborn. And otherwise, there are multiple protocols which have been published for how to take care of these newborns in the delivery room, as well as when they are rooming in with mother, and then subsequently after discharge. Second thing is about the protection of the healthcare workers. So healthcare workers may come in contact with children in OPDs, in indoors, and as we are aware that majority of these children are having either mild disease or asymptomatic, and they may be having some other underlying disease for that they are admitted, but they may be infected. So that's why all the healthcare people should be observing due precautions. For example, if they are seeing they are sitting in the OPD, then they should be we should be following these three measures. Like one is distancing, masking, and frequent washing of the hand. And the parents or the attendants should be minimal in the OPD. And after each patient, we should be observing cleaning of our hands. We should be wearing proper PPEs and washing our hands frequently. So this is about the, you are screening them at the entry in the OPD. You are observing these three precautions. And then after each patient, you are washing your hand as well as using appropriate PPE. Same thing is observed in the ward. And as it was already pointed out, you should try to avoid having some procedures like in which there is a generation of the aerosol which may transmit the infection. Though there is a COVID facility is separate as compared to the non-COVID children, but as I said, all children may be infected and you may not be able to pick them up. So in those situations, something like a nebulization, something like giving some aerosols, then we should be very cautious and observe due precautions before giving these. So this is about how we can reduce the this thing. Those who are posted in a COVID care area, in that situation, you have to wear type level 3 PPE. But those who are posted in ward or in OPD, level 2 should be fine.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Sushil. The newborns must be given the full right for skin-to-skin care, KMC, early initiation of breastfeeding, rooming in. If mother is positive for COVID, the mother must practice the usual procedures for protection from transmission, like wearing a mask when caring for the baby, washing her hands frequently, and trying to prevent coughing and sneezing so on others. So normally we recommend in the elbow, in the fold of the elbow. So all those precautions, mothers must be allowed to take care of the babies. The babies who become positive, Dr. Sushil reminded us, they are usually mild. The usual mother care is possible, the nursing care possible, and the protection of healthcare workers is our own responsibility. We must universally follow the personal protection procedures as much as possible. So thank you for reassuring us, and I want all these 200 people who are online to promote these evidence-based practices that breastfeeding in positive women is still the best practice. Even if there is a minuscule chance of vertical transmission, the risks of not breastfeeding and dying of other infections, which are very common, is in our children in low resource settings, that is even more harmful. So breastfeeding and rooming in and skin to skin care must be promoted. Dr. Sushil, you mentioned in one of your slides that if children are positive, and if respiratory rate is higher, you give amoxicillin. So that means we have to be careful about the comorbidities in our children. Even if there is a positive test for COVID infection, there still can be comorbidities like pneumonias from other bacteria, malnutrition. It's a dengue season in some part of the country. In our region, it could be malaria as well. So we have to be careful about the comorbidities also. So otherwise, the mortality will go high. If you don't treat for comorbidities, only get carried away by the COVID infection, then we are in deep trouble. So the next set of questions is for Dr. Rakesh. There are specific questions on treatment of severe disease, like fluids and prognostic factors. And then there is a question on which pressor support is better in these conditions. So if you can kindly address the specific ones. And also, Rakesh, if you can again clarify the role of specific treatments in serious disease or otherwise moderate disease through specific anti-COVID treatment, which is being used in different countries. There are questions related to that.
Okay. Over to Rakesh. Thank you, sir. So I think about when we talk about fluids for management of fog, I think the guidelines remain the same. We use isotonic fluids. It could be normal saline, it could be Ringer's lactate or balanced salt solutions. The bolus rate is 10 to 20 ml per kg. One just needs to be careful to carefully monitor so that we don't end up overloading or causing harm, just as we would do in any child with shock. So that's one thing that we need to look at. Second component is about use of the vasoactive drugs, which we said be required early. So if a child is hypotensive despite fluid resuscitation, in that setting, a drug of which may be better, maybe low dose epinephrine is what we may begin with. Again, now these are guidelines which are not evidence-based for COVID per se, but just guidelines for management of shock in children. If hypotensive, then other option would be dopamine that could be used. Dobutamine may be considered only if we are thinking about cardiac dysfunction and there is no hypotension. In that setting, dobutamine may be used, but epinephrine would be a preferable drug. In terms of the specific antiviral drugs and so on, so as I highlighted, we really don't have any evidence base to support use of these, and even data that's coming from adults at best is some modest benefit with a couple of molecules. So in that setting, again, these would have to be a clinical judgment would have to be used. The series that I highlighted from Brazil and New York actually didn't use much of antiviral drugs or biologics, and they were mainly managed with supportive care, and the outcomes in their settings were reasonably good. So I think we need good intensive care. Till we have definitive, there may not be too much point in really, using multiple drug combinations, maybe hydroxychloroquine or, azithromycin, ivermectin, drugs like remdesivir and so on. Yet some of these may be used in a desperate setting. So I think these kind of cover some of the aspects about the management of shock part and some of specifically about the antiviral drugs. The main thing we are saying is that, again, data being adults is also still not really robust. In children, there are no trials to support, give any data for evidence-based recommendation. And therefore, one would, you know, just be using these drugs a bit cautiously.
Okay. So thank you for clarifying. So people, members in the audience, this is very clear. There is a lot of uncertainty about the disease even now after 6 months of pandemic. We are still struggling with the knowledge about the evidence about these various. So there were questions about transmissibility from children. There is no evidence at the moment to say that children would spread it more. In fact, the evidence is contrary. In the school settings where reopening had happened in countries, if there were secondary cases or new cases detected in after reopening, the minority of cases were contact traced to the school itself. Most of the transmission happened outside the schools. So we don't know if the children get infected or carry asymptomatic infection into the schools, and in a closed setting, there are so many of them together, even then transmission is not happening. Do we actually know what is the transmissibility? So we have to wait for some of the answer. The studies are being mounted more and more in these settings where we would understand whether children can be efficient transmitters. Similarly, the uncertainty is there about the clinical specific treatments. So WHO has been saying there is no clear recommendation. We are still waiting for the randomized controlled trials, but there are guidance to use it as off-label or in clinical research scenario, or if the countries take decisions because of experimentality of the treatment, and countries are taking those kind of decisions. So therefore, I don't think we have clear answers to some of these questions. These are uncertainties. So there are two more questions, if you allow me to go on for 3-4 more minutes. Sushil, can you tell us about if the newborn is positive, detected positive on 6th day, will it be a vertical transmission or horizontal transmission? And second question is, when do you vaccinate neonates who were positive, their routine vaccine, when can you start? So if you can answer these questions, then I move to Deepthi after that.
So it's fine that if a patient, if a newborn, a baby is detected to have a positive at on day 6, that it is difficult to say, but the median incubation period is 5 to 7 days. So either it may be that it is just after vertical transmission, or it may be just after the birth. It is very difficult to say that whether it is a vertical transmission on day 6. Second thing is about vaccination. So it should be, if someone is infected, child is otherwise in a usual health, then we should be following the routine vaccination program. There is no specific guidelines regarding these newborns with infected with COVID. So we should be following the similar national schedule as long as the newborn or baby is otherwise in a good health.
Okay, so thank you for clarifying that. And there was a question whether there is a reported or a confirmed vertical transmission in India or the region. I don't think we have a confirmed case yet. From our region, China did produce a couple of cases. We don't know whether certainly they were, because more and more testing is being done on amniotic fluid, cord blood, breast milk, vaginal secretion. So several investigations are on, but the jury is still, how much can we expect vertical transmission? So we will have to wait for those answers. There are two or three questions for Deepthi about the registry. What kind of ethical clearances or clearances from the government will be required to join such a registry? That is one question. And secondly, do we already have some details on how the communication is going to hospitals to join? Is there a ICMR website where we can see the plans which they have announced? So if you can answer these two, three questions. But clearly, these are early days. We do not have experience of running a registry until now. So those questions will have to wait. But the other questions Deepthi will attempt to answer, which I just mentioned. Deepthi, over to you. Maji. Chalo.
Dr. Deepthi, can you please unmute yourself? We can't hear you.
Yes.
Okay. So, yeah. So, I've been able to unmute now. Okay. So, as the Dr. Mehta has just shared, these are, you know, very, very early days for, you know, initiating the work on the two, you know, registries that I have just mentioned. But as far as information about these registries are concerned, when it comes to the pediatric, you know, COVID cases, we hope that our partnership with the Indian Academy of Pediatrics will bring in the clinical establishments and hospitals that are interested to be part of it. And mostly, I think these will be private hospitals who are, you know, willing to share the data. As far as, you know, permissions are concerned, yes, ethical clearances will be required. The requirement would be at the institutional level. And in some states, we've seen that even the state boards have been constituted whose clearance and permissions are required in advance. So yes, these permissions will have to be in place. And when it comes to the, you know, the initiative for pregnant women and children, we have gone through our WHO collaborating centers. They have their own network. That is how, you know, we brought in 21 hospitals together. And as far as the ICMR is concerned, we do have information that there are going to be 15, you know, apex hospitals which are going to mentor another 85. But as of now, we don't really have, you know, specific information about that. Maybe Dr. Lodha will be able to share a little more about, you know, how to access the details of the ICMR registry. But as far as the other two India examples are concerned, I have just shared with you that these are early days. And let us see, you know, how we progress with, you know, engaging with the hospitals. And we do have plans for managing the data. We will have a team dedicated to managing this. And the ownership of this data will, at this point of time, is with the participating hospitals, the WHO collaborating centers, as well as the pediatric associations. So it will be a shared, you know, ownership for the data. And based on the contribution made by the different partners, I think everyone will share the ownership of the data. Thank you. Over to you, Dr. Mehta. Hello? Hello?
Dr. Rajesh Mehta, can you unmute yourself?
Yes, now I got unmuted. Thank you so much. So thank you, Deepthi, for these answers. And we still have to find a way to manage this. But the advantages are very clear. Best is to join the global database if people can, because this is de-identified data. There are no privacy issues. It's a protected domain. Otherwise, we can set up our own registries, paper-based or electronic registries. The idea is to understand the disease well. So we can take care of this duplication of reporting, and all this is a method of, is a process-related question. And clearances, of course, ethical clearances, permissions would be required. So thank you so much. And I thank all the experts, Dr. Lodha, Dr. Kabra, for their time and express the opinions and sharing the details. I also thank the audience. We still have about 150 people waiting to disconnect. So thank you so much. And thanks to Dr. Raina and Dr. Dilip to have provided us the opportunity to do this webinar. So we close here. Over to all of you. We meet next week, same time, on a different topic related to care of the elderly people during COVID. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.